the bill, House Bill number 5452, an act declaring, House Bill number 5511, an act establishing the southwestern Tagalog region to be known as the Mimaropa Region by Representatives Ramirez Sato, Rodriguez, Chipeco Tan, Suarez, Reyes, Madrona Umali, Aragones, Lichon Alvarez, Abueg, Hagedorn, and Rivera. And likewise, House Bill number 5452, an act declaring the second week of November of every year as Economic and Financial Literacy Week. And Senate Bill number 2779, the same, an act declaring the second week of November of every year as Economic and Financial Week by Senator Sanyangara. First item of the agenda, Chairman's statement, before I turn over to our committee secretary to acknowledge the resource person. Before I read my statement, please, ComSec, please acknowledge our resource persons for today.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. May I thank everyone, especially from the resource persons, for coming here today to our public hearing. May start calling on Congresswoman Regina Reyes from Marine Duque. Thank you, ma'am, for coming. Congresswoman Josephine Sato from Occidental Mindoro. Thank you also, ma'am, for coming. And of course, Assistant Regional Director Carl Mando from the LG Southern Tagalog. Mr. Ricardo Tuquero, from Development Management Officer from Department of Finance, and Attorney Chiamu Vasquez from BSP, and Director Antonio Cintura, also from BSP. Thank you, everyone, for coming to our public hearing.
Okay, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. An important piece of legislation will be tackled shortly before us. I would like to thank the good representative from the Lone District of Mindoro, Congressman Sato, for persistence in passing this bill, as this would help the Mimaropa region maximize its economic potential and, more importantly, address the needs and distinct issues of its people. And of course, likewise, the chair would like to acknowledge, of course, the presence of Congresswoman Gina Reyes. Thank you also, ma'am, for supporting this piece of legislation. Region 4B, or the Mimaropa region, is composed of Mindoro, Oriental and Occidental, Marinduque, Romblon, and Palawan. It was a creation of Executive Order No. 103 in 2002, which partitioned it to the Southern Tagalog region, the other half being Region 4A, Calabar Zone. This creation of the two administrative regions in the Southern Tagalog was done precisely to promote efficiency in the government and to bring socioeconomic growth in the regions. The chair understands that there has a move before to separate the province of Palawan from Mimaropa, but was objected by its people. Through the passage of this bill, we will prevent this kind of uncertainty in the future, which could greatly affect regional economic standing. What the chair would ask from our invited resource speakers is to enlighten the committee on the economic relevance and potential of the bill. The chair also needs to hear from the executive agencies on the administrative implications of this bill. NEDA's input on this is also very important, as the agency tasked to draft the implementing rules and regulations once this is passed into law. On this note, the chair would now like to hear from our resource speakers. Of course, you may hear the first the comments of the authors of the said measure, the proposed legislation from the House of Representatives. Let's start with Congressman Sato and probably Congresswoman Regina Reyes right after. Ma'am, you have the floor.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. And I would like to Thank you for scheduling the hearing of this bill, because this bill has been filed and refiled for several congresses already. And hopefully, this will finally pass in this Congress. And we also thank you for emphasizing the main objectives of this bill, which is to pave the way for the region to determine its growth thrust and provide more attention to the island provinces. Because we all know that the island provinces of Mimaropa, the development trusts are agriculture and tourism. Which is very different from the Calabar zone, which is highly industrialized area. And the second main objective of the bill is to promote efficiency, economy, and greater impact in the delivery of government services to the region. For the information of this committee, Mr. Chairman, we do not have a separate regional offices for Department of Tourism, for the Philippine Ports of Authority and the Marina, but these, which are very crucial for island provinces comprising the region. Four out of five provinces in the region have large number of IP population, and yet we do not have an NCIP as a separate regional office for Mimaropa. Practically all the national government agencies do not have full complements, because we just rely on the savings of the Calabar zone to fund the full complement of the different national government agencies. In view thereof, Mr. Chairman, we really appeal that this bill be passed here in the Senate and finally become a law. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, ma'am. Congresswoman Regina Reyes, please, you have the floor, ma'am.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I come here in support of the Mimaropa bill, because even if it's not been formally established, we have been in fact existing as what's called the Mimaropa family. All of the congressmen and the governors in this region are very united. In fact, we've been able to get solid support from the Regional Development Council, and all the national agencies will agree that when one member of the Mimaropa bloc, they call it now in Congress, disagrees, then all disagree. In fact, Mr. Chairman, not to preempt you, but in celebration of your approval, or your hopefully in celebration of your approval, the President of the Governors League, Governor Umali, is sending this invitation to you for what is now called the first Mimaropa Festival, which will showcase agriculture, tourism, and trade fair, a trade fair to be held in Calapan, Mindoro on November 14. And in fact, the celebration is a week-long celebration. And as we speak, even without formal establishments of any legal framework, we already operate as such. So your approval of this bill is most urgently sought for. Thank you.
Thank you, Congresswoman Reyes.
Can I submit this to the committee to allow to be part of the records? Because it was providential that in spite of the many postponements, that it was held today, and the celebration start on Friday. Invitado po kayo. Thank you po.
Okay, the committee secretary is requested to have this copy and be put in record. So to have a very smooth flow of today's proceedings, we will ask all the resource persons, and the chair would just like to ask some questions right after. Okay, so thank you to the authors, of course, to the author, Congressman Sato, and likewise to Congressman Reyes. At this point, the chair would like to ask first the DILG your opinion on the said measure, and then right after the Banco Central. Assistant Regional Director Carl Rimando, please, you have the floor.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman. As mentioned a while ago, we have been in existence since mid-2002, separated from Calabar zone, Mimaropa. We have surveyed all the governors and the other representatives of the region, and they're very enthusiastic in passing, finally, Republic Act as our legal basis for existence.
So, did you Did you pass the, you presented the position paper already? And then,
yes, sir.
Is this an official or official po ito?
Hindi pa po, sir.
Ah, hindi pa.
Sir, we lang po namin.
Ah, okay. So what's the recommendation? Are you in support of
yes,
sir. Is the LG in support of creating the creation of a separate region?
Yes,
what's
sir.
Called the Mimaropa Region. Kaya lang, it's not yet official, no? Can we make it ask when could the secretariat or when does the committee have a copy?
Your chairman, as for the existence of Mimaropa, we have no problem with that. What we have surveyed is the other bill proposed that the regional center be transferred to Pinamalayan instead of Calapan City. But as for the existence of the region, very supportive po lahat.
Okay, thank you, Director Rimando. Mr. Ricardo Tocuero, do you have any... Wala, may sabihin mo eh. Okay na.
Regarding the declaration of the second week of November for economic...
Okay, sorry.
Thank you.
Okay. So, from the BSP, either Attorney Michelle Vasquez or Director Antonio Cintura. Sir, madam, is your position on the creation of...
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, but the Banco Central has no position comment
on
this. But we have comments on the other bills, House Bill 5452 and Senate Bill 2779.
Okay, that will be taken up with you right after the Mimaropa measure. First question, regards to the operations in the regions, benefits, privileges. While the proposed measure is pending, what are the problems and issues that the Mimaropa inhabitants are facing with you in due to the absence of the law, no, creating the region? Ano pa ho ang, ma'am, can you, like as you said kanina, no, yung wala, may mga IPs and there's no agency, no national agency sa ngayon. Because sa ngayon po ba yung nasa ng region, nasa Laguna or sa Quezon City?
Oh. Yes.
How about the Mindoro po, ma'am?
Some of the regional, some of the national government agencies, Your Honor, have transferred to Calapan City. But most of the other national government agencies have not transferred yet to the Mimaropa region. Some of them are in Makati, some are in Laguna, some are in Quezon City. So we don't.
What agencies, ma'am, are still? So the LG is still with Quezon City, and others, ma'am, as you said, are still in Makati, no?
Yes, and some do not really have yet their regional government offices established for Mimaropa region.
Yes, Congresswoman Reyes.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. One very important area where we were encountering problems was in the area of tourism. For until recently, it was lumped with 4A. So our thrust to be able to develop island tourism and the peculiar characteristics of our different provinces was very much impeded. So knowing that tourism is the thrust of our economic plans, we'd like to be able to really earmark our regional development goals in line with the characteristics of our geography. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
That's very, I think it will be very justifiable because, of course, Calabar Zone, like Laguna, Cavite are industrial. And yung trust will be, it's different, no? So I think it's justifiable, no? Really justifiable. And I be assured of our support because of that. Especially the operation side, no? There is really a need to establish, and hopefully the other offices, no, like BILG, we I hope that upon the passage of this measure that you will already transfer, because you know it will affect definitely, no, yung delivery of services and the operations, no. Tignan nyo na lang kung halimbawa kay Governor o Mayor, if you need something, they have to go to all the way to Quezon City or Makati, as what Congresswoman Sato said, no? So I guess that really makes sense, no, to have all the national agencies be located in Mindoro, no? So that in Mimaropa Region will be we'll have a more smooth flow of operations. What will be the biggest or most immediate impact if the proposed measure will be passed? Ma'am, what do you think will be?
The most immediate impact on the passage of this law is to have a separate budget for our national government agencies or line agencies for the region. Because as of now, especially the DTI, the DSWD, they really complained of not having enough personnel complement, because they are now operating only on the personnel that were given to them by the Calabar Zone. So all the budgetary requirements of the line agencies are all dependent on the savings of the Calabar Zone region. So we have become beggars for a budget for our line agencies, Mr. Chairman.
And also what other problems or our programs will be affected if in case this measure is enacted? Hindi naman ho kayo makaka sa buong regionan. Region 4, no? Region 4, 4A and 4B.
Sa amin po sa DILG, yung pong tinatawag naming regional pride. Kasi po, pag naging meeting po, laging 4A, 4B. So kung finally magiging DILG Mimaropa, medyo magkakaroon po ng moral boost.
Mr. Chairman,
yes, ma'am.
We don't also want to be called 4B. Because we're always the poorer relative of the richer region, the Calabar Zone. So we would want to be called a separate region, Mimaropa. And because before, Mr. Chairman, we are on the top of the list of the, in the poverty list among the poorest provinces in the nation. But when we started as a special region or a separate region, The NEDA even came out with a report that we have become one of the fastest growing economy in Luzon. So if we could have a formal creation of the region, then I think the development growth would be faster.
Ma'am, what are the executive offices already in Mimaropa, and what are the other agency executive offices still outside, aside from the DILG? Ano pa ho yung ibang offices na kailangan natin i-establish doon sa ano? Marami ba?
Mention DOT,
APPA,
DSWD, Marina, NCIP, DOT. We already mentioned DOT. Yeah.
And what will be your suggestion as to where the regional center will be? In Calapan? Calapan ba?
We would like that the regional, we have agreed that the regional center will be established in the province of Oriental Mindoro. As to where in Oriental Mindoro, it's still a subject of discussion. And there is a separate bill pending in Congress for the establishment of the government center either in Calapan or in Pinamalayan. But both municipalities or cities are in the province of Oriental Mindoro, Mr. Chairman.
So that, I don't know, we will just be waiting for that. We'll ask for the decision, but you have all agreed that it will be in Oriental. Okay. Okay, since there now the chair has no more queries, and I fully support this measure, of course, to improve the delivery of services, and likewise to promote, of course, the economy of the region, which is tourism oriented. It has to be separate, no, from the industrial side, which are the region 4A. So dapat mag-iba talaga, no? So be rest assured, ma'am, Congressman Sato, Congressman Reyes, that this committee will support this bill. In fact, we will not anymore refer this to technical working group. I would directly prepare the committee report so that this will make it before the 16th Congress adjourns, of course, for the benefit of all the provinces of Mimaropa. Be rest assured of our support.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. We'll announce this in the upcoming first Mimaropa festival on Friday. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am. So at least we have be rest assured that we will try to do this before we adjourn this coming December. Thank you, ma'am. So we will, of course, you're now excused, ma'am. We will go to the next agenda. No, we just suspend. We will also wait for other senators to come. Suspend lang muna. We're just waiting for other senators to have a quorum. Mga 10 minutes po. Okay, this committee hearing is now hereby called the session is resumed. Madam Secretary, please acknowledge the resource persons again for this particular measure.
May I thank the resource persons who are here today from the Department of Finance, Mr. Tuquero, Attorney Michelle Vasquez from BSP, Director Antonio Cintura from BSP also. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Likewise, the chair would like to acknowledge the presence of my colleague, Senator Trillanes. At least we already have a quorum. Thank you, sir. I know you are a very busy person. Aside from fulfilling his duties, I know that he has to go around, but he is still with us this afternoon. So thank you, sir, for being with us this afternoon. Next item of the agenda is the statement of the chair regarding this measure. Again, I thank my colleague, Senator Tillanes, for providing the quorum this afternoon. I thank also the resource persons for attending this public hearing. Your input to the proposed legislation before us is material for committee subsequent actions. Our agenda for today are Senate Bill number 2779 and House Bill number 5452, or the Economic and Financial Literacy Bill. The Senate version is authored by Senator Angara, whereas the several representatives authored the House version. The bill proposes to make the second week of November of every year as Economic and Financial Literacy Week. The objective of doing so is to promote the consciousness of the Filipinos on the country's economic and financial positions. By doing so, we are inviting our fellow Filipinos to take part in making sound financial decisions as their contribution to the improving state of our economy. As Ben Bernanke, the then chairman of the U.S. Federal Reserve, observed during the onset of the global financial crisis, the financial preparedness of our nation's youth is essential to their well-being and of vital importance to our economic mortgage market. In the light of the importance of our economic future, in the light of the problems that have arisen in the subprime mortgage market, we are reminded of how critically important it is for individuals to become financially literate at an early age so that they are better prepared to make decisions and navigate increasingly complex financial marketplace. The chair believes that mandating economic and financial literacy among citizens is a commendable legislation and complements the administration's battle cry for inclusive growth. We are also grateful for the cooperation of the private institutions in today's hearing, as they will assume a big role once this bill is passed into law. We shall be getting your positions on the matter, and if possible, your suggestions on how we can effectively implement the intention of the measure. On this note, the chair would like to hear the positions of our invited resource persons. Let's start with NEDA, and then we'll go to BSP right after. Okay, so Mr. Ricardo Tuquero, NEDA is not yet around. No? I stand corrected. Since NEDA is not yet around, I'd like to ask representatives from BSP, Attorney Michelle Vasquez and Director Antonio Cintura, for your position, your agency's position regarding these measures.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The Banco Central fully supports these legislations, House Bill 5452 and Senate Bill 2779, which seek to develop and enhance national consciousness on economic and financial literacy by declaring the second week of November of every year as Economic and Financial Literacy Week. These measures are very timely in light of the growing recognition of the importance in economic development of financial literacy both internationally and locally. In the Philippines, one of the key developments in fostering Financial Inclusion was the crafting of the National Strategy for Financial Inclusion, or NSFI, which was launched in July 2015. The NSFI is aimed at establishing a framework for collaboration to reduce the level of poor and financially excluded segments of the population in support of the government's inclusive growth agenda, as indicated in the 2011-2016 Philippine Development Plan. This framework is expected to provide the government and relevant sectors, such as the private sector and the civil society, direction in taking a more harmonized approach toward financial inclusion. So this crafting of the NSFI was spearheaded by the Banco Central in collaboration with 12 government agencies. Also, the House Bills 5452 and Senate Bill 2779 are aligned with the Banco Central's Economic and Financial Learning Program, or EFLP. The EFLP brings together under one flagship program the Banco Central's key economic and financial learning activities. The EFLP embodies the BSP's thrust to promote inclusive and proactive economic and financial education among its stakeholders. The underlying vision of which is that a citizenry that is well informed in economics and finance is a more effective partner of the Banco Central in maintaining the effectiveness of monetary policy, as well as in ensuring a stronger and safer banking system and payment system. It is also noteworthy that the Monetary Board has recently approved the Financial Consumer Protection Framework. This framework will be applicable to all BSP-supervised financial institutions. It will ensure that all BSFIs are responsive to the needs of the financial consumers by setting out minimum standards of consumer protection. We also have specific comments on the role of the NEDA, which we believe plays a strategic role in coordinating the entities that will be participating in financial inclusion. Given its substantial experience implementing programs for inclusive growth, including economic and financial literacy programs, the Banco Central can also render assistance to NEDA in the development of a framework for the advancement of this initiative. The Banco Central also supports the recognition of the key role of the Philippine Information Agency and the Presidential Communications Development and Strategic Planning Office in raising awareness and understanding of the economic and financial concepts and issues among different stakeholders. And the Banco Central believes that the PES, or Philippine Economic Society, is a well positioned to encourage the involvement of the private sector and civil society in this celebration of this National Economic Financial Literacy Week. And lastly, since there is no common date in celebrating Economic Financial Literacy Week, the month internationally, the proposal to hold the Economic Financial Literacy Week on the second week of November in the Philippines does not deviate from any global standard of practice. These are the excerpts, Mr. Chairman, of the position paper submitted by the Banco Central last October 28, 2015. And the other details are there, submitted to the committee secretariat. Thank you.
Thank you, Director Antonio Cintura. Attorney Michelle Vasquez, do you have any input? Okay na. Mr. Ricardo Tocuero of the Department of Finance, Development Management Officer. Sir, your position, your department's position on this measure.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I have a position paper prepared by the Chief Economist Office of the DOF. Allow me to read it. The DOF welcomes and strongly supports the proposal, as we have long recognized the importance of economic and financial literacy for the following reasons. To empower all Filipinos to manage their finances, we believe that a better understanding of the factors affecting money growth and how it can be properly utilized will affect people's attitude in handling their hard-earned money. Filipinos will be able to develop healthy spending habits that are well-aligned and well-managed. And there's a mention here about the Nielsen second quarter consumer confidence report that survey that says Filipino consumers are now among the world's most conscientious savers. Filipinos start to spend less on new clothing and save on gas and electricity, and the savings rate in the country is still low, as reported by the BSP. There's a mention here about a survey saying that only one out of four Filipino households has savings, and that two of three households have savings bank accounts. This will also develop a sense in the need to be financially secure for the future, as they will start to put their money in banks or invest in productive investment products. Again, there's a mention about BSP's national baseline survey on financial inclusion. That's July, published in July, that most Filipinos do not have available funds to fall back on when an illness or tragedy occurs. Again, it will enhance awareness of existing financial products being offered, promoted by the private and public sectors. With knowledge of various investment products available in the market, Filipinos will have more options diversifying their investments based on the risks preference rather than solely relying on the conventional and traditional ways of saving and investing their money. Moreover, the bill will promote the government's goal in achieving financial inclusion in the country, as it will offer greater opportunity for the underprivileged and underserved sectors to gain better access to financial products, in particular microfinance, microinsurance. We also wish to note that the DF, through the National Credit Council, has conducted financial literacy programs throughout the country for the past several years, focusing on microfinance and microinsurance as part of the central strategy of poverty reduction in the country. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Ricardo Toquero. I presume that both the BSP and the DOF fully support this measure. No? I just have a few clarificatory questions before we end today's proceedings. Can you elaborate as to the impact of high economic and financial literacy on the of citizens to country's development? What would be the importance of the impact of itong economic and financial literacy of every citizen for our economic development? From BSP or from DOF? Yung advantages lang of of educating our families, because according to the survey, only 4 out of 10 Philippine families have savings. So what would be the impact on our development if we would be educating our Filipino families? Any
Okay.
Yes, Mr. Toquero.
So, I think when it comes to saving habits, I think surveys reflect Filipinos' attitudes or traditions when it comes to savings in banks, those traditional mechanisms. I think BSP is in a better position to speak about our banking industry or consumers or depositors. But our agenda here is for informing our citizens from early age up to across all ages to promote savings and investment in all options available for them according to their risk aversion or risk scenarios. And we've been advocating financial literacy for several years, and I'm sure BSP has been doing the same for students, for FWs maybe, and for other sectors our nation. So I think we still have to improve on what we've been doing. I think BSP is doing a great job, and then other agencies also are doing the same. So we also have projects that have something to do with financial literacy, funded by grants, raised from donors. So I think it is important that we have a special schedules to celebrate economic and financial literacy, and maybe even strengthen linkages among agencies, and trying to inculcate to students or non-students why savings is important, why we have so many issues regarding investment, like scams. And that's because maybe those investors haven't been informed properly. So I think this is the proposal is very timely, and it may go beyond financial aspect, and the economic aspect is even more broad, in general. We can have venues for discussions about OFW plights, the social cost, family cost, that's still under the purview of economics, or maybe a fiscal scenario that's still within the purview of economic agenda. So,
does the DOF have any current program, no, that seeks to educate Filipinos in terms of economic and financial literacy? Meron mo ba kayong programa at present? Can you please inform the committee?
Yes, sir. In fact, in our office alone, which is the Fiscal Policy and Planning Office, we started this traditional quarterly lecture several years ago, where we think about topics which are mostly economic and financial in nature, and then invite audience from other bureaus and agencies. And at the same time, we also welcome students, study tours, a group of students from universities, even from the provinces, and then we do lectures about financial literacy and economics. That's free of charge.
Thank you. How about BSP? Do you have any current programs
BSP is, Mr. Chairman, one flagship program. We call it the Economic and Financial Learning Program. This program embodies the Banco Central's trust to promote inclusive and proactive economic financial education among its stakeholders. The idea of which is that a more educated citizenry is able to more effectively participate in the economic activities. It's a choice, you know. Sinabi natin sa latest APEC Finance Ministers meeting, sinabi nila that financial literacy is a critical life skill among the citizenry. Kailangan natin ito para ma-improve yung ating savings based on the choices made by the citizenry. If you improve your savings, then we can use these savings as investments and promote economic progress also. At the same time, they will be able to make use of the systems and other benefits in the economy kung marunong silang gumamit yun. So financial inclusion means that more people will have more access to the financial system. They are more protected from scams, mga ganun. So in effect, overall, malaki yung ating benefits from these financial literacy movements, you know. And the Banco Central has many learning activities going on right now, from the children, the basic curriculum to professionals. We do learning activities that are adjusted to the audience that we do.
Director Siduro, would incorporating it, no, with CHED or DepEd, yung economic and financial literacy lessons into the curriculum? Would do you think it would it help at least educate Filipinos further?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. In fact, we have already arrangement with the ED on the elementary schools. You know, so we are planning to do it higher, high school and college, maybe as looking forward to this. You know.
So there was already a move, or there's already a current program by the BSP to with the
curriculum for the elementary school children. And we have the pro movement. We go around classes in elementary and high school, and we actually teach them how to save and invest, basic skills on savings and investment consciousness there. Right now will be latest event would be in Ormoc. Within this month we'll do integrated learning activities there from high school to professionals and so.
And that's good to know that the BSP already has a program, you know, together with CHED or and the DepEd regarding educating our youth on the importance of financial literacy. Would these resource persons know that what other countries are you know, celebrating economic and financial literacy month, day or week? Meron mo bang ibang bansa?
Based on our initial findings, sa Canada, sa November din sa the same as November, but more on the monthly basis, you know? Diba na? Yeah. So USA is saves weekly, America saves week, that's February 23-28.
February.
So, California.
So USA is February?
Meron sa April.
Meron din April, okay.
California Financial Literacy Month. April, yeah. And then iba-iba, meron din annual, this more on annual basis, you know, annual Military Consumer Protection Day, July. That's the US, you know. And Money Smart Week, April. In Australia, it's National Literacy Week, August. Canada naman is Financial Planning Week, November. And Latvia is on March, Financial Education Week, March. Malaysia, 8 and 24, March, March also. In the Philippines, we have, this is when, there's a series of activities, but it's not a weekly celebration, but a series of activities that we do. That's what our findings have, Mr. Chairman.
Anybody also, no, the chair would like to ask any of those resource persons. What is the significance of setting it in the second week of November for us? Any significance of the month of November for the economic or financial sector? Meron ba masagot? Wala na. Kasi November ang nakalagay, no? Proposed.
Baka ano? Kasi malapit ng bonus pag November, pwede remind din how to save.
Para maubos ng December.
Mr. Chairman, other possible options, kaya lang hindi. Ano ba yan?
At this point, the Chair would like to acknowledge Dr. Johnny Ravallo, Assistant Governor of the BSP, who joined us this afternoon. Thank you, sir, for coming.
Advocate also the financial inclusion main object.
Sir, may we hear from you with regards to your agency's support for this measure?
Mr. Chairman, there is no doubt that there is value to supporting financial literacy. There are several international studies. The BSP is part of the OECD, which is the global agency for setting the standards for financial education and financial literacy. We are actively involved in several of the standard-setting committees. And the findings are all consistent that those who actually are made aware early on do better in life. I wanted to make 2 points, Mrs. Chair, as my brief intervention. Number one, when we talk about financial literacy, it's not just knowing that income minus consumption is saving. It's not enough to know the technical details, whether you can compound simple interest or annuities. Hindi po yun ang pinagtutuunan ng pansin. When we talk about financial literacy, we're talking about the technical details plus displayed behavior. Yung technical details, so kailangan makita yon sa pang-araw-araw na behavior ng tao, yung kanyang attitude towards the current and the future, and the formal equation of that, ang pinaka-suma total doon, is measuring improvements in financial well-being. Kung tayo po ay pinanganak na medyo kapuspalad at namatay po tayong kapuspalad, maliwanag po na walang improvement tayo. Whether economic or financial, kahit turuan mo pa yan ng kung ano-anong technical details, pag hindi po nag-improve yung financial well-being, yun po ay direct evidence that financial literacy has not been achieved. The second point, Mr. Chair, is we have several baseline studies conducted by the World Bank, by other third parties, as well as private institutions. Ang lumalabas po kasi sa atin is even for a survey, even for participants who say that they are experts, bumabagsak po tayo sa literacy test. The typical Philippine score in a 7-question survey, global, ang average po natin 3.2, ni hindi man lang kumalahati. Meron pong private sector survey where the respondent, 20% of the respondents said, expert kami, alam ko yan. Pinagkuha ho sila ng test, 92% got lower than 80. Nabanggit ko po doon sa committee on banks kaninang umaga na kung ako ho ay umuwi ng bahay na may report card na below 80, eh, grounded na ako niyan for life. And yet, experts in the Philippines actually don't get a score above 80. Only 8% got a score above 80, pero wala pong pumalo ng 90 and above. And when you take a look at the actual skill sets, division, only 77% actually can divide. When it comes to interest, knowing how to calculate interest, kalahati lang ho nakakapasa nun. And when you compare all of these results across country, these are the same questions run across several countries, we are in the bottom one-third. So countries like Mozambique, Kenya are well above in the rating. Tayo po nasa mababang lugar, no? And then finally, Mr. I mentioned 2 points. I beg your indulgence, I make it 3. When it comes to financial literacy, hindi po pwede na pareho ang mensahe natin kahit saan tayo pumunta. When you go to Ilocos, you don't tell people to save. Thrifty na ho sila. So ang issue doon is paano sila, saan nila i-deploy yung kanilang saving. Kung pupunta po kayo sa isang lugar na ang average age ng population is, let's say, 62, 63, you don't really tell them to invest long-term anymore. Why? Kasi po ang average age ng Filipina is 72. Ang average age ng Filipino is 67 only. So kung ang lugar nyo ay 63 na, medyo may, ano na ho yun, sagal na yun kung bumili pa kayo ng 15-year bond or 10-year bond. Nasa, hindi naman na po natin sasabihin na huwag kayong bumili. But you have to give them their choices. When you go to Cebu or Davao, they are industrial in nature. So the context there is not so much whether they can deploy. The context there is given their income stream, can they save? We, as mentioned by my colleague Tony, the BSP actually goes from locality to locality. Meron po kami mga financial expo. Nagmamount po kami ng isang linggo sa probinsya. Meron po kaming particular case na this province has been growing top 3 in the Philippines for the last 6-7 years. But if you take a look at the more specific data, ang unemployment po niya ay pumapalo ng 45% to 52%. So you cannot go to that place and say, save. Eh, wala akong trabaho yung tao eh. What is my point, Mr. Chair? While we can establish a national strategy for financial literacy messaging, ano po ba yung mga messaging? Kunwari po, you have to save for retirement. You have to save for an unexpected rainy day. Pag tinapo kayo sa ospital, kailangan ho ng down payment. Huwag po kayong uutang ng labis-labis. Yung over-indebtedness is a global issue. And don't fall into scams, given all the electronic and technical detail. We can establish that as a national message, but the delivery of those messages will change. You will have to calibrate them from one locality to the other. Yun po ang experience namin sa Banco Central. We have done this advocacy for many, many years. And we continue to learn by talking to our people when we go to the provinces. We've also had experience talking to our OFs overseas. So kami po ang pumupunta sa Dubai, sa Singapore, kusan po, basta may OF, pupunta po kami doon to give them a sense of what their options are. The bottom line there, Mr. Chair, is you really need to empower them by giving them choices. And those choices are supposed to improve their financial well-being. So at the end of the day, it cannot be just the buzzwords that you have to say for a rainy day. It has to be tactical in nature so they can execute them. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Hey, thank you very much, Dr. Johnny Ravalo, Assistant Governor of Banco Central, and likewise to the other officers. Your interventions are well taken, very much well taken. And since the Chair has no more questions, I'd like to thank all the resource persons and be rest assured that all of your inputs will be included in the committee report that we will be preparing. We will not go into technical working group, we will go directly. Likewise, as with other measure, we would directly, the chair would like to be preparing the committee report so that hopefully before this Congress adjourns, the 16th Congress, we will be able to pass this measure. Again, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for being here this afternoon. Thank you very much. This meeting is adjourned.